Thank you for joining us despite the amazing weather outside and with 1 hour of lost sleep. But we are very excited to get the day started with a debate or a discussion around permission and permissionless blockchains. So that's exciting. For that, we have Peter Todd, who's a Bitcoin core engineer, and Jamiel Sheikh, CEO of Chainhaus, and moderated by our very own Reese Lindmark. Let's welcome them. Reese, I'll let you take over.
Thank you. Okay. Can you hear me in the back? Nice. We got a hands up. Thank you all for being here. Thank you two for being here. Thank you all for being here early in the morning to learn on a daylight savings day in the snow. Seriously. Today we're going to chat about permission versus permissionless blockchains. We're going to be chatting about Zuckbucks and Jamie's diamonds or whatever you want to call it. The goal here is for this to be kind of like a moderately contentious, non-contentious, like anti-debate, where we learn more about, does it work, by the way? Okay, see. A moderately contentious, non-contentious anti-debate where we learn about everybody's perspectives here and get deeper understanding. So with that, could you just give me kind of a quick intro on who you are and why you're interested in cryptocurrency and blockchain?
Well, I'm Peter Todd, and I work as an applied cryptography consultant, and I think, really to get down to it, why I'm interested in cryptocurrency is really freedom. You know, a big picture is that if you can control people's use of money, you essentially have probably even more control than you do if you control their use of speech. So, since I was really a teenager, I realized this and thought, this is a good thing to go work on, and fortunately, someone smarter than me figured out how to make it actually happen.
Nice. Good.
Jamiel. Hi, good morning. My name is Jamiel. I'm from New York City. I run a company called Chainhaus, which is a advisory education and venture studio. I have about 20 years in technology and in the enterprise. I am also a professor at three universities. I teach at Columbia Business School, NYU Wagner, and at CUNY. I teach graduate level blockchain, AI, and data science. I run one of the largest meetup groups, the blockchain meetup groups in New York City. We're about 5,000 people. I do events about twice a month. And I'm currently writing the Accorda book for O'Reilly.
Cool, awesome, thank you. And just to check, what interests you in the technology? What draws you to it? Yeah.
So I would agree with Peter. Yeah, it's kind of the
You're not allowed to agree. Wait a second.
I disagree with Peter.
There we go.
I think it's a new way of thinking, and I think we're in the early stages. I'd like to see where it goes, and it makes money. So
cool. and I think just to check with the audience before we start, who here? I mean, so there's a range of opinions here, from like the skeptical side, or from the excited side to the skeptical side. Who here is excited about generally permission systems and like enterprise use cases? So who's excited by that? Okay, nice. And who is skeptical of that? Okay. I don't really need to ask my other question then. Sweet. So we all have nice textured views of everything. So I think the first question that I'd ask both of you is, when we think about like defining a permission chain, a permission blockchain, that term is kind of anathema to some people, and it is a strange term. How would you define it, especially in comparison to something like a distributed database?
A blockchain is a chain of blocks, to be clear. Git is essentially a blockchain, so I use permission chains every day.
Got it, yeah. Do you agree with that?
So, no. So I think the term blockchain is going to morph. And it's going to get broader. And I think my view is that it should be more encompassing. If the reason we have blocks in the blockchain is because we have slow consensus, like consensus is occurring slowly, and that's to accommodate, let the dust settle in terms of consensus. But that doesn't mean that a blockchain has to have slow consensus. If you have an enterprise and they need to do whatever they need to do in somewhat a disintermediate way or somewhat of a decentralized way, and they can do it rapidly, and they don't need blocks, which happen to be these buckets to store uncommitted transactions while the dust is settling, then that's a blockchain that doesn't happen to use blocks.
So. Why do you think a blockchain has blocks in it?
What's that?
Why do you think a blockchain has blocks?
No, well, you said, you just said that, right? You just said.
No, but what's the purpose of it?
Of blocks?
Yeah.
It's, you know, it's just while consensus is occurring, you're queuing up and storing transactions. For example, well, with enterprise, like certain permission chains, you have consensus per transaction. So I have an agreement on transaction, I store it, and I'm done. I don't need to have it kind of queued up and sitting in blocks and waiting for consensus to occur.
I think there's, I mean, it's a weird, and there's a lot of different pieces that we could touch on here. There's one question, which is it append only? There's another question, which is, who can access that system? Is it, you know, can anybody access it, or can only permission folks access it? Who can add on to it? Not only who can do transactions, but who can actually validate blocks and send them to the network? There's a bunch of different pieces, like smart contracts. Is that part of the system? So I think that there's.
But I think we also, though, have a really fundamental question of, you know, is this a traditional consensus-focused system, mm-hmm. or is this a correctness-focused system? Because normally in consensus algorithms, the academia is focused on coming to consensus. But it hasn't focused on, well, what is actually a correct consensus? You know, an example I like to give is how, in traditional academic systems, if a machine fails and does something that makes no sense, like, you know, creates money out of thin air, if the system comes to consensus, that's considered a success. Even if the rest of the machines in the network decide, well, we'll accept this completely and obviously bogus transaction. But a traditional consensus system, there is no definition of bogus. So coming to consensus is by definition a success. Whereas in our systems, we have a definition of correctness, and then we have some consensus mechanism. But because we have the definition of correctness, if you come to consensus on incorrect set of data, that's considered a failure.
Yeah, I think there's, I mean, I feel like there's a lot of, there's a consensus piece versus the correctness piece, which I agree with in terms of how people, and there's the traditional academic sense, and there's also, as the academic field's starting to get built up, how that looks compared to the practitioners out in the field and how what they're thinking about. I also think a weird piece here is like the governance of these systems. But I guess I want to go a click deeper here and say, so if we can assume that a permissioned blockchain is some kind of, it says we might not totally agree on what exactly it looks like, but what are the things that you could see it as being useful for or not useful for?
I mean, anything where you would have a database, you might as well throw in a blockchain on it for auditing.
Yeah, I don't know about that, but I think the root justification or motivation for a permission blockchain is data privacy, right? So that is, hey, I'm doing transactions and I don't want the public to see the transactions, right? And for whatever reason. So the way I view the world is that technology fits use cases. Use cases should not adapt to technology. So I take a use case, I have a business need, I have a certain need, I need to accomplish certain things, and therefore technology needs to accommodate that, right? So technology needs to move civilization forward, right? It's not that we as a civilization are somehow beholden to moving technology forward, right? Technology will only move forward if it moves civilization forward. So certain businesses need certain use cases fulfilled, and they will have those use cases fulfilled with permission chains. Terminologies don't matter, right? We can call it whatever we want, permission, not permission, unpermission.
See, I suspect we have like a really, really fundamental disagreement on what this tech is. You know, I mean, for instance, for you to go and talk about, you know, blockchains being slow just makes no sense to me. Because, you know, a chain of blocks for auditing purposes, I can crank up the transactions per second on that as fast as I want. You know, I mean, literally, you can go to my blog, petertodd.org, read the most recent blog entry, and I go talk about how you could create a trustless with respect to validation permission system that'll do, you know, O log N scaling, and like run out the math for how you could do, you know, 4 billion transactions per second on it. It's really not a big deal. It just requires a certain approach of tech and a recognition that, you know, you put this crypto in there for auditing. Ultimately, what the state is. I mean, Bitcoin, as an example, is a database whose state transitions are driven by blockchain.
So, I mean, I think there's two disagreements that I could see there. One is the one that I want to actually push on is, Jamiel, you said that you're interested in this stuff for privacy, and Peter, you said you're interested in this stuff for auditing, and those feel like kind of like categorically opposed opinion or disagreeing opinions.
No.
Okay.
It's funny. I did, after all, work for R3, and I'm partially responsible for the design of Corda, and a lot of the discussion around that at the time was actually how do we achieve auditing and privacy? And I may be pushing my luck here, legally speaking, but long story short is there's lots of banks who want very, very hard to figure out how to go and hide things from regulators while still abiding by the regulations. Mm-hmm. And a great example of this is, well, if I have a bank that does business in two countries, I want to ensure that I meet my regulatory demands in both of them simultaneously without giving regulators in another country data that I didn't absolutely have to. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yep, that makes sense. So you can both have auditability and privacy in that sense. I think another part of these systems that I feel like comes up a lot is like the consortium model and how both the governance works there and how you're trying to get lots of people together to agree on, because if you have just like one company using something like, whether it's a permission blockchain or you want to call it a database, whatever you want to call it, they have like access to all their APIs, they have read-write access, they can do whatever. But if you imagine, you're like, oh, let's actually, instead of trying to interoperate between all of our APIs with us and all the companies, let's actually just make a shared, you know, permission blockchain infrastructure that gets everybody aligned around that. Do you guys feel like that use case is interesting at all?
I think the benefit of, so there are drawbacks to consortiums, and there are sort of benefits. So the drawback is that a lot of these consortiums are just bureaucratic, and they're not getting anywhere, they're not going to get anybody anywhere. But at the same time, the upside is that you build software that's specific to needs, mm-hmm. certain needs, as opposed to building technology and then finding a solution for it, mm-hmm. or finding somebody to use it. And then with a consortium, it's like, hey, what are your needs? And let's build around that. And I think that's how some of these permission chains, like Hyperledger, Fabric, and Corda, are kind of like going about and say, hey, what's happening here? At the same time, though, we see that consortiums have some drawbacks, which is if you're not a member of the consortium and you're putting your business on that platform that consortium has produced, you will probably have some second thoughts about that. Yeah.
So I'd make the point that shared consortium databases have been a common thing for a very long time. You know, and I mean, probably a good chunk of you used one to get here, because of course you bought airplane tickets. And the whole airline industry runs on shared consortium databases of airline tickets and bookings and so on and so forth. But in the sort of traditional model, because the tools you have for auditing are so poor, it's very difficult to go and scale these things and have a lot of participants without actually in the background having, you know, single points of failure, essentially, where some entity actually runs the database and people then just connect to it. Mm-hmm. And in theory, you know, adding crypto to this can help change this. Mm-hmm. But I think from the governance point of view, it's not going to look that much different. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, in case of, say, an airline ticket, I mean, there's pretty clear reasons why you would have a shared state and you'd have a set of people actually controlling it. Mm-hmm. You know, I think it more just lets you go tweak exactly what that governance looks like, mm-hmm. and make it more closely match how you want your legal agreements to actually work. Because mm-hmm. after all, you know, in the airline industry, with traditional technology, there is no way to have every airline have a say mm-hmm. in the back-end databases. Mm-hmm. You know, the technology to do that just doesn't exist. Mm-hmm. With blockchains, you can go do that. Mm-hmm. And you can set up, you know, the data structure in such that, yes, every airline had a vote or had something, you know, approval mechanism or had a say in it. And one of them can't go screw over the other.
Yeah. I think that it reminds me of this is a microcosm of the more general blockchain and crypto mindset towards things, which is, oh, We can now remake all the things. Let us be economists and lawyers and complex system folks and computer scientists and distributed systems researchers. And now we know all about permission systems. In fact, well, there are these utility networks, which are, you know, these third-party systems. There's like the airline industry, which has this underlying layer that people are already using in this way. So I think that a lot of the crypto folks just look at that and go, ooh, let's like do that now too. And that's not exactly how it works. So I want to transition over to, from chatting about permission versus permissionless systems here for a second, more generally to specifically some of the big announcements that have come recently, the Zuck Bucks, i.e. Mark Zuckerberg and Facebook, spinning up a blockchain team. The JP Morgan's team is interested in having what seems like kind of like some stable coin variant here, JP Morgan coin or the Diamonds, TM. I think that there are, and also Zuckerberg recently had has just made a post on privacy and how he's, and let's start on that. He says, a privacy-focused vision for social networking. So this was a post that he just had recently, just a couple days ago. Everybody's laughing. I think it could be a legitimate thing, who knows? And he makes this distinction between the town square, which is what Facebook has been thus far, this public social networking system, versus the living room, which are more private interactions, encryption, reducing permanence like Snapchat, safety, interoperability, and secure data storage. So what are your thoughts on like Zuckerberg saying, hey, we might be super into privacy now?
Yeah, what are your thoughts on letting Hannibal Lecter babysit your children?
Initially skeptical. Initially skeptical. he will put the lotion on their skin or something. I don't know.
I'm sure some of his thoughts in there are genuine, and that's after long discussions with his lawyers about how to avoid jail time.
Yep. Jamiel, do you agree with that initially?
Well, I don't know. You know, like I have no comments regarding Zuck and his plans, but I think the whole JPM coin and the whole Zuckbucks now is indicative of a trend, an important trend, which is I call it enterprise tokens or enterprise coins. I think that's an important trend where we're going to have coins emerge and these economies emerge within this kind of B2B systems. And I think that's going to be an area of growth. Mm-hmm. So on one side, we've got the Bitcoin and the Ether kind of spreading in the public markets, and then within B2B space, we're going to have these coins emerging. And my organization, we're working with that kind of technology and those kind of use cases are going to be coming out from the privacy world, and they can potentially spread fast enough across large enough organizations. So with JPM, you can get onto the JPM coin if you're an institutional client. It would spread fast enough to become a de facto standard. And it can potentially, put a wrinkle in the future of some public crypto, because once you have these B2B organizations, and now will that are we in the early stages of this? Yeah, we're in the very early stages of this. I can see lots of organizations, including maybe Amazon, launching a coin like that, offering discounts to people that use that coin and say, hey, you want to purchase something, use an Amazon coin, you'll get 5% off. People will start storing their money in Amazon coins. I think we're kind of in the early stages of that. What does that mean for crypto? I think that's an interesting question.
See, I think when you talk about things like JPM coin, like Zuck coin and all this, I think what you're actually seeing here is not so much, I mean, particularly things like JPM, which are meant to be, one-to-one peg, I think what you're not seeing is so much technical innovation. I think what you're actually seeing is political and regulatory innovation. And why I say that is, I think Bitcoin created the environment where the existence of coins sort of becomes accepted. It has to be accepted. You can't really make it go away. With the tools regulators have available to them, they've been completely ineffective at stopping Bitcoin. Now, when you think of the tools they could have used, I think you make good case that, the U.S. government example could go stop Bitcoin. But then again, the U.S. government can extinguish all life on the planet given their nuclear arsenal. In practice, they don't use tools that extreme, so they look completely ineffective, which then creates opportunities for companies like JPM to take advantage of that political landscape and start trying to create their own coins. But when you talk about creating their own coins, that's just another iteration of things that have already been done many times over. The difference between JPM coin and PayPal isn't that big. In PayPal, when you look at the early history of it, very clearly wanted to create a coin. But they didn't have the right political environment to do it, so then instead they called it a payment service. But the tech between PayPal and a JPM coin is roughly the same. You know, the APIs can look roughly the same. You might have a bit of crypto to go and change a few, you know, auditing things and maybe change some of the APIs, but it's really not that different.
Yep.
You know, what's different is things like Bitcoin, which can exist in spite of regulatory pressure.
So I think, I mean, this reminds me of what Jamiel was talking about before, where we have this tech-society loop where tech is changing society, society is changing technology, and we're seeing here how the technology of Bitcoin has made a societal infrastructure and myth such that what we think of as nation-state fiat is not the only money that can exist in the world, but now Bitcoin can exist, now random companies can have their coins. There's also like central bank digital fiat that's starting to happen here. So I think what I would ask is, do you think, so as we think about what you call the enterprise coins, whether it's JP Morgan coin or the Zuckerberg coin or whatever, and then also as we think about at the Digital Currency Initiative, we're thinking a lot about central bank digital fiat or central bank digital currency, and someone like Bermuda and San Marino are starting to think about pushing that up. Do you think, and as those co-evolve with Bitcoin, you can imagine this as like an evolutionary ecosystem where they're going to be competing for more, whether it's throughput or whether, you know, like aggregate market volume or whatever. Do you think, how are you thinking about the macro end outcome here, both how they're going to compete? And let's say that someone like Facebook or, you know, one of the non, like, crypto native folks are starting to win here. How would you feel about them winning? Would you say like, oh, like congratulations to them, like they're still pushing for this? If they're pushing for a privacy-focused future or something, would you be into that, you know?
But Visa and MasterCard already won in many respects. Like, you know, when you're talking about the sort of things that they already compete well in, I mean, Bitcoin doesn't have a hope. Whereas if you're talking about the sort of things that Bitcoin has a chance of competing in, where you have regulations restricting the flow of money, the Visa and MasterCard of the world have a very difficult time of competing either. You know, maybe the better example would actually be, you know, the international payments systems like Western Union. You know, when you look at history of Western Union, it's mostly a history of dodging regulations all around the world and paying, you know, billions of dollars worth of fines and fees and so on to make this happen. Of course, we don't, you know, we don't recognize that because we just go see the friendly Western Union agent. But that's what's actually happening in the background there, and it's a constant fight for them for how do we keep running in these crazy countries. You know, that, I think, is actually better competition to Bitcoin.
Yep.
You know, Visa and MasterCard, I mean, it's just, it's hopeless.
And so let me push on that for a second. So if someone like Western Union were to drastically decrease their fees or were to change their, like, censorship, like, if they were to be more censorship resistant or something, would you feel like, ah, they are evolving more towards Bitcoin's, you know, mindset, and therefore, we like this. This is the outcome we want.
I wouldn't say it's evolving towards a mindset. I'd just say it's effectively competing. You know, if you really wanted an example, very scary potential competition for Bitcoin, you know, my Canadian government, we actually almost did this, where the Canadian Mint, you know, which historically has produced coins and paper currency and so on for many countries and has this whole thriving business there, I think they institutionally wanted to survive, and they proposed a hardware-based digital currency system, where long story short is it would have been very difficult for the Canadian government to censor once they created it, and it would also have very good privacy. Well, of course, the project got canned. But had it gone through, you know, you would have had anonymous payments over the internet that are difficult to go shut off. That would have been a very powerful thing. And, you know, will a government decide to actually make this happen? Maybe.
So that's a great question. So in my conversations with a bunch of different enterprises, and I meet with a bunch of them on a regular basis, a large number of them are considering enterprise coins, right? And so there is this convergence of, hey, what can we take from Bitcoin or Ethereum that we can leverage? You know, are they thinking about a brand new world? No. Are they thinking about how do we become more operationally more effective cost-wise? Yes, they're thinking about these kinds of things. And will crypto, you know, the cryptocurrency technologies that are kind of in the public space right now be something that they leverage? Absolutely, they're definitely going to be leveraging that. I actually just got an email from somebody from Bermuda You mentioned I got an email from somebody there asking me to come down there and take a look at that. I know, and I can't disclose certain names. I can't disclose the names of these companies. And a lot of them and countries, they are all considering this kind of B2B kind of enterprise token, which would not be on a public blockchain. Now, just to clarify, I'm a big proponent of Bitcoin. I believe that I kind of have a radical hope for Bitcoin, which is that it disrupts central banks, which I think is problematic in terms of the value that they provide to society. But at the same time, I think there's going to be this kind of one side's coming from one way and the other side's coming from the other way, kind of like how Windows and Apple had the UI, and their underlying technology was kind of a little buggy, and then Windows had the underlying technology, or Linux or Unix had the underlying technology, but didn't have the user interface, and they kind of converged today where you can get both, right?
Yeah, I think that and something for us to think about long-term is like, I think that there's something, there are both some very positive and very negative aspects of like the cryptocurrency and blockchain, like ethical, philosophical mindset. And so thinking about how to like, if possible, to spread the positive parts of that as these other people get integrated into the system and to kind of reject some of the negative parts of that. So I guess one maybe final question here before we go to the audience is, one other kinds of permission versus permissionless systems that people are thinking about is these new kinds of smart contracting platforms like EOS and Cosmos and things that have greater transactions per second, so someone like EOS has 21 validators or whatever they're called in their system, and it's a relatively, it's on the spectrum of permission to permissionless because you have 21, not a fully permissionless miner ecosystem. What are your thoughts on things? And like recently within EOS, they have like a blacklist where they try to blacklist people. They tried to blacklist a certain address, but then one person got into the validator set of those 21 and then was able to produce the next block and then without blacklisting that address, and then that address was able to send their coins to a bunch of different places. So what are your thoughts on kind of these new smart contracting platforms, especially the permissionless nature of them?
I think that nearly all of them are terrible with atrocious technology that makes no sense. EOS being an example where they have a full, have everything consensus model. And I think it was more likely than not deliberately designed to be terrible because you want to make it very difficult to get into that validator set. You don't want competition. Whereas things that actually do make sense are things that are validated client-side, things that actually scale, things that also are not very complex. And in Bitcoin, in production, Bitcoin is probably the most successful smart contract platform because it's very simple. Because it relies on doing very simple things very clearly that actually work. And I'd also make the point that I talk about smart contracts as just an extension of legal contracts. Many people have a very, very different view on that. But what's important is to, have a contract that you can enforce with technology. That doesn't necessarily mean you have a complex language. Lightning is an example of a smart contract. But what's crazy about Lightning is the actual on-chain script is actually the same as different use cases. Because the little part of Bitcoin that actually drives Lightning is a very simple primitive that can be used for many different use cases. It's not like you put all the logic of Lightning into the chain. Rather, you put the absolute bare minimum and then remind yourself that most of the logic is actually on the clients and how you use the chain and how you make an agreement and what UI you show to users, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. That's where all the complexity is. And none of that fits into the model of, well, we're going to make this new coin and we're going to get rich.
Got it.
What was the question?
The question was, for these new smart contracting platforms that have permissioned validator sets, how do you think?
Got it. So I think EOS is an interesting case study. I think their technology is somewhat raw. I was working with some people that were building applications on EOS last year, and EOS is not as big in the US as it is probably in Asia right now. But there are people that were building on the US platform, were not really happy with the tools. I think some of the underlying technology is interesting. I think it's an evolution. I think the problem that EOS had is a problem with a lot of things is when you get $4 billion, people come into your organization with disingenuous intentions, that can create problems, right? And so I think EOS has a bad economic model in terms of how they have structured themselves. And I don't think they'll be around, 5 years out. Bitcoin will be. But to your earlier point regarding smart contracts, I think smart contracts need to get, and I'm going to disagree with Peter here, the smart contracts need to necessarily get more complex. They need to get more involved. And platforms that are on the permission side involve smart contracts that execute over days, right? So a long-lived transaction is a smart contract that's executing, and it takes days and days to execute because it's kicking off business workflow and processes. So I think we'll start to see more robust smart contract platforms emerge. We're working with some of these platforms, and they're Turing complete full smart contracts. They can take a full programming language like Java or Kotlin or JavaScript to build on instead of a very specific purpose-made smart contract language like Solidity.
Well, let's be clear. The actual infrastructure for the Lightning smart contract is written in Turing complete languages. Mm-hmm. It's just that the infrastructure happens on your client, on your Lightning client. That's where the smart contract is, not actually on the Bitcoin side.
So yeah, there's a distinction for these platforms of where what happens on chain versus what happens both on the chain and at the consensus kind of blockchain level versus at the client level. And then also, I would say that another mindset to think about here is this platform grade versus sovereign grade censorship, where you think about who can get into the system of validators and change it. So with that, let's open it up for one or two questions. If people have some questions, do you want to come up to the mic, Soup? Yeah, do you want to go to the mic? And then do you want to follow up to the mic? Yeah. You might need to, can we turn?
I can just be loud.
Nice, yeah. For the live stream, there we go.
Great. Okay. Thanks, so Arisu and I spoke about this last night a little bit, but I was just thinking, I have this conspiracy theory that Facebook is just trying to save advertising and, talk about this shiny project about a coin over here, but really they should just, or they're thinking we should just roll out a permissioned, JP Morgan-like network and save data because we have all these apps that are cutting us off. We have, real-time bidding is over. So what do you think the likely, and also I felt like when they started talking about a coin, it felt like when Microsoft bought Bing and was going to crush Google, which obviously didn't happen. So how difficult or easy are both of those? And just, I'd love your views.
I mean, I think you're right to be suspicious of what Facebook's doing there. And the point I'd make is Facebook's problem is a business model problem. Facebook's problem is that they're reliant on advertising money, and the best way to go and make advertising money is to violate privacy left, right, and center. And regulators are catching up to that, and that entire industry may just disappear. I mean, particularly when you look at things like Europe, where so much of the money being made is in foreign countries, and if you're a regulator in Europe, you have every incentive to go side with your local companies by creating regulations that make the foreign country's entire business just not exist anymore. That's a very sane kind of political move to make. And I just don't think this really has that much to do with cryptocurrency, with one exception where if payments over the internet become easy enough, you can create businesses that are paid businesses that provide whatever service people need and are not relying on advertising money. That may actually be the really big innovation. And that's difficult to do with conventional systems for regulatory reasons. The technical cost of a PayPal transaction is effectively zero. Updating the bits in the database is free, for all intents and purposes. Whereas, at least based on what I've heard talking to people at PayPal, their regulatory cost for a PayPal transaction is on the order of like 10, 20, 25 cents, which is insanely high. How do you have that much work going into updating a few bits? Well, because of anti-fraud and so on, and et cetera, et cetera. And one of the easiest ways to get around this is just say, well, yeah, things are private and AML KYC no longer exists. That's a very, very, very effective way to push that cost to zero. And depending on the way things evolve, that could be what happens with Bitcoin. Or alternatively, it could be what happens with, you know, Panopticon coins where the government gets every single transaction and, you know, runs whatever database searches they want, which is a very scary future too and would make you much rather a Facebook.
Do another question. Yeah, we'll do two more questions and wrap. Yeah.
So I couldn't resist. You mentioned smart contracts, and then you said many smart contract languages are Turing complete, like Solidity with a huge manual. Why is that a good thing? I mean, look at that thing. Didn't you guys ever hear of the halting problem? Are there no computer scientists in your entire company? So why a Turing complete language? Why is that a good thing? Because you can have less expressive languages that can do a hell of a lot, and you can look at Nick Szabo's original paper as a little side note.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't say it was a good thing. I said it was indicative of more complex smart contracts coming in, right? So the fact
unprovably
that,
correct.
What's
so
that?
The unprovable more complex contracts.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it's more.
Not a good
thing. Yeah, well, whether it's a good thing or not, it's just that smart contracts are becoming more complex.
Yeah. I would say it's actually the opposite. To make complex smart contracts, you need simpler things that you can actually go test.
Thank you.
Because, like I think you're hinting very, very, very strongly, if they're complex enough that they're Turing complete and so on, they will fail in production, and you will lose a ton of money.
Silently fail.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, let's do the final question. Yeah.
So kind of talking to the notion of governments potentially getting involved, property rights are managed very differently in the real world legal system and in crypto. Like in the real world, you own your house because if someone tries to take it from you, the government will, with the threat of violence and coercion, make them give it back or, you know, remediate that somehow. Whereas in crypto, they're enforced more automatically, immediately through cryptography. How do you think about in the case of like JPM coin, where it's likely to that some of these transactions are going to be tied to real world assets, how do you think about bridging the gap between property rights on a blockchain enforced by cryptography and math and property rights in the real world enforced by governments and the legal system? Is that even a gap that can be bridged, and is it worth trying?
I would actually put that in the category of sort of an Achilles heel for the likes of, you know, JPM coins, because ignoring, you know, sort of the more legal social side of that, dealing with that kind of fuzziness is expensive. Really, really, really expensive. It's one of the reasons why, you know, my example of PayPal, the cost is like 20 cents per transaction, because every time you have to do a fraud investigation, you know, you burn a lot of money trying to figure out what should have happened. And you also see this in the finance world, where in many cases they try very, very hard to make things much more like Bitcoin, where you screw up, you will lose your money. You know, there exist things like, you know, computer terminals for certain niche financial things where it's very clear, whatever you type in that terminal, you are now legally obliged to, and we will take every step we can. You know, it's why, like, many types of use cases of wire transfers, there really is no mechanism to get your money back if you screw up. And a lot of that, it really comes down to reducing costs, because ambiguity that's not crypto-like is expensive to deal with. You know, do consumers like it? Well, not necessarily. I mean, it means people can lose a lot of money, but it is an option, and it's useful for society that things like Bitcoin exist. And you can tell it's useful for society because it's already being done in the financial world anyway, but we just don't see it because we're not professionals.
We're gonna do actually one final question, yeah, and then.
My question is about, like, on the focus on data privacy. What do you think about the compliance with GDPR? I noticed that hasn't hit. You guys haven't hit that topic, but can you explain more about how blockchain either can help with GDPR compliance, or is that something that should be taken more seriously?
Yeah. So it's a prevalent problem in building solutions around blockchain. GDPR is a concern, and so. Because permission chains tend to be more data privacy oriented, it's easier to handle. So, for example, to store somebody's NPI data, you need to potentially encrypt it, and, you know, like hashing it is not sufficient by the GDPR statements themselves. Like if you look at the paperwork there, it's that if you hash it, it's insufficient. So what can you do with a public chain in terms of storing NPI data? Well, number one, how would you put that on there? If hashing is not sufficient, would you encrypt it? Now you're talking about potential issues in terms of storage and costs, right? So permission chains are more amenable to being compliant with GDPR.
I just find it interesting that for the right to be forgotten and something like blockchain is forever on there. It's just kind of like, how does that even work? It's like going, it's like a train and a truck. It's like, it's
so I'll point out, I think that's actually a big myth. And the reason is because it is very easy to construct a blockchain system where data does get deleted, because nothing in a blockchain actually requires the data to be kept. You know, a blockchain is just a data structure. And, you know, to be concrete about it, I mean, imagine like Bitcoin. Well, Bitcoin has the headers, and then it has a Merkle tree of transactions in every block. Nothing actually prevents those transactions from getting deleted. You know, this is just data. It exists on computers around the world, and if someone deletes it, it gets deleted. And if you create a blockchain using infrastructure where you make the promise that you will delete that data, that's no different from any standard database and so on. What really matters is, well, who got the data in the first place and who can keep it? And a blockchain is orthogonal to that question. Now, on the other hand, if you have a system, like a blockchain system, where you are exposing the data to a variety of people, like any other system, you're greatly increasing the risk of having a privacy violation. And a blockchain doesn't make that better or worse, but it doesn't necessarily make it any better either. You know, that's a really important thing. And what I think is more important is to find ways to not have the data in the first place. You know, I think things like Bitcoin show that really well because of the privacy parts. You know, in Bitcoin, we have, of course, Lightning. Well, Lightning, from a privacy perspective, is really good because it scales, and for its scale means that not many people have the data in the first place, and the data of transactions gets thrown away very quickly. You know, those are the kinds of systems you want. Of course, those kinds of systems do not play well with more regulated environments where people, you know, regulators want to have a database of every transaction ever so they can go through, you know, their AML KYC searches. And well, what do you know, GDPR has all kinds of crazy carve-outs for keeping data for regulatory purposes and criminal investigation purposes. You know, in reality, GDPR is actually pretty toothless against the biggest threats you actually face, which of course are governments. You know, that's your biggest threat as a citizen to your life and liberty in most places, and GDPR has carve-outs for that. But if you fix that problem, yeah, I mean, blockchains would be orthogonal to that.
Yeah, I mean, so the current crop of blockchains don't have a delete capability. So I think, I would agree with Peter, that can a blockchain have this capability of deleting, right, or removing? Yes, it can be anything. It is a database at the core of it. But with the current crop of blockchains and where there are people are kind of thinking about immutability and all that, and that's kind of like attributed to a blockchain that it must be immutable. And obviously, Ethereum is that way, that you can't go and put something on Ethereum and change your mind later, 3 days later, and say, I need to delete it. Then GDPR becomes an issue if you're in that space, say, hey, I need to build something on Ethereum, which also now lends to the idea that I think, and we're moving towards this idea of hybrid permission and permissionless chains, where I have certain things that are occurring on permissionless chains, and a certain portion of that is also on our permission chain.
But, I mean, let's be clear. Mutability and deletion are not actually opposed concepts. You know, you can make data immutable while still also losing it.
Yeah, you know? I agree, but I'm saying that's the market perception, is that, hey, if it's immutable, it's not deleted. I can't delete it. So with the current, I mean, there is no blockchain out there right now that you can delete data. So if there is one, and if there will be one, then maybe it makes sense to have a conversation at that point around that.
I mean, today, I think we're talking about, you know, 20 lines of code basically at the core to go do this. You know, your real issue is more the problem where the very fact that the people got the data in the first place is the issue. You know, that's where we see data leaks coming from. You know, like it or not, people will have nodes set up that do not respect delete. And your real problem was that they got the data in the first place. In much the same way that GDPR challenges we see in databases is that, you know, companies give data widely amongst themselves. They give data to their contractors. You know, blockchain is just orthogonal to this issue.
Okay. Thank you.
Sweet. Okay, so with that, let's give our panelists a round.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.